about academic research, no practical application. And the example I provide works at another scale of urban systems, mainly at systems of cities. The research question it was about is providing an explanation and modeling urban growth, the way cities differentiate through their growth rates. And it is a difficult question in social sciences because many individual interventions, many stakeholders can think that they indeed determine the local growth, or they have to provide actions for enabling their city to grow better. But when you look at the growth of sets of cities over a long time period, you find many statistical regularities and a kind of distributed growth, which is, however, difficult to predict because there are many fluctuations, both locally and over time. A long time ago, in the 30s, a model has been suggested to summarize this growth process. It is the Gibra stochastic model, leading to a log normal distribution of city size. And it is interesting because it explains why the spatial and temporal pattern of the city size are so robust over time, as you may see on those maps showing the size of cities in Europe over more than one century, and in India as well, the spatial pattern remains rather stable. Also, the population of cities is growing exponentially. The same for the complex different systems here in the former Soviet Union. And all those urban systems have the same statistical distribution of city size, which is known as ZIPF rank size rule. So already from those simple statistical analysis and comparing database, harmonizing database and so on, we can infer some knowledge about the process. And deliver some science to urban stakeholders. However, we have to insist, because they don't believe us usually, that those urban structures in space, in territories, are really very strong feature of the spatial organization of territorial systems. And you can see if you display the distance between cities at 25 kilometers here in Europe for all urban agglomerations above 10,000 inhabitants, you find three typical patterns, and you find them again if you have a stick of 50 kilometers, or if you raise the size threshold to 100,000 inhabitants. So the urban hierarchies are very, very strong object and very sustainable, because they have been created through the territorial organization of nation states mainly, but this come back to 5, 6, 7 centuries before us. So we try to understand the differences in urban growth rates and city size, looking at the evolution of socio-economic structure of cities, their profile documented by the censuses through employment activities. And we used a multivariate analysis over different time periods to summarize this evolution. And we discovered, this was a surprise, the big parallelism between the urban trajectories. Cities change the content of their socio-economic profile at the same time for decades. They go all in the same direction. They transform themselves all together. And this is true in all urban systems we have investigated here in the US as well. And what is interesting is that from those multivariate analysis, that if you map the scores of cities on the first differentiating factor, indeed, the principle of organizing those differences, those qualitative differences between the functional profile of cities, comes back to this old innovation that was the first industrial revolution, especially marking all manufacturing cities around the Great Lake regions. And if you look at the second dimension of this structuration through the multivariate analysis, you find a trace of the second half of the 20th century change in urban activities, which is the development of financial, real estate, insurance activities, which occurred mainly in the largest cities of the system. And this is the normal hierarchical diffusion of innovation, which boosted the size of the already largest cities, whereas in the smallest towns, in blue here, you find all the activities that were not developing much and that were decreasing in importance during this particular period. So knowing that, we can better model the co-evolution of urban trajectories and also explain some deviations we have seen for long since from the stochastic growth model. We also can better understand why among the emerging properties of a system of cities, we have not only the hierarchy, but the functional diversity. And we also can understand why some individual urban trajectories have bifurcations. You remember this ontology we have developed of cities as systems within a system of cities, and the emerging properties at all levels stem from interactions inside levels and between levels. I won't detail that, but in this process, if you compute the relative size of one city at different dates, you obtain a trajectory of its relative development compared to the rest of the urban system. You have continuously decreasing, for instance, Rouen, that was industrial city, very close to Paris, and so relatively, since two centuries, it is a relative decline. You understand the bifurcation in the development of Detroit, rising through the mobile industry and having less importance since, whereas on the contrary, Dallas, which is developing with the oil industry, has a continuous growth since. So we have this theory of an innovation flow that is partly created within the cities. He is developing them. If cities adapt continue to this flow continuously, they become metropolis, but they may over-specialize and enter some cycle of decline with the activities that they host. Of course, restructuring is always possible, but sometimes difficult. So the challenge was to try to reconstruct with a multi-agent system those differentiated urban trajectories in order to assess the validity of our theoretical hypothesis and, of course, ensuring the quality of possible future predictions. We are proud to have made the first application of multi-agent systems in geography. And from this first application, we were able to show that we can reasonably build an urban hierarchy starting from homogeneous agricultural centers at first, and then having an input of innovation flows into the system. But we were able, with limited computer power at the time, to make those simulations, a few hundred simulations for each model, but we were not sure about the validity of the estimated parameters. We knew that the conditions we had introduced into the model were sufficient, but we didn't know if they were necessary for building the urban hierarchies according to this type of pattern here over 2000 years with an increasing slope of the rank size rule, and as observed, and a rather complex multi-agent system model with many rules and hypotheses in order to be able to reproduce reasonably the systems we knew. So we had many different models of the same SimPop family. And what is very important is to know that they were developed into different research teams. During 15 years, we were able to hire only PhD students in computing. They made very well successively models, but all, of course, in different languages, because computing softwares were evolving very rapidly. And it is only because of a big funding that in 5 years, we succeeded to work really in a proper group between a team of geographers and a team of computer scientists on a daily basis, and we applied models on systems of cities for Europe, United States and BRICS countries using this OpenMOL platform that Romain will tell about in a few minutes, and using evolutionary algorithm and distributed computing. And what we had learned about the processes of evolution when comparing Europe and US, which I want to develop here, was moreover reinforced by two important contributions of Clémentine Gottineau. You see here how the interaction model of SimPop type, she called it Marius, is more efficient in predicting the simulated population compared to the observed ones, compared to the Gibra stochastic model. But what she developed with the OpenMOL platform was a new a new way of building model. She built multi-model, starting with the simplest possible hypothesis, and progressively elaborating different versions where you can add mechanism of interaction between the agents of the model, or adding interactions between the agents and the environment, and you can compare the ability of those models to fit the observations, and so you have a stick for evaluating the predictive quality of your model, which is more or less rich in hypothesis. Moreover, with another model which as the first SIMPOP model tried to generate an urban hierarchy with a rather simple hypothesis, a restricted number of parameters over the period between the Neolithic period and the emergence of a system of cities, with Clara Schmidt and Sébastien Rehaug on the simulation platform OpenMOL, it was possible to really have a step forward in the number of simulations for exploring the parameter space of this model. We were able to have half a billion simulations on the same model, and with another software elaborated by Romain Royon, it was possible now to demonstrate that the hypotheses in the model were not only sufficient, because so many models are able to reproduce urban hierarchies, but they were also necessary. And this is made possible by this calibration profile that Romain developed with Clara Schmidt at first, and which also is now used by Clémentine and Just Rimbaud. And you have the fitness statistics on the y-axis. Each point here in the graph is one simulation made all on the validation domain of one specific parameter, and all the other parameters explore their full variation domain in those simulations. And you see that for a few parameters, we get a minimum fitness distance to the observations, which marks that they are necessary to obtain the result. And there is only one parameter that we could remove from the model because it creates no variation in the fitness. So this is a very important step for comforting the theory, the evolutionary theory we have on the development of systems of cities at different time periods, with mechanisms changing between the time they were environmentally constrained locally, when they could apparently develop without any limitation, and nowadays where we have to consider the rarefaction of resources, and we have to try to find other solutions, but perhaps using this magnificent network of cities all over the world to convey the solutions from the top or from the local initiatives in this urban hierarchy. So really OpenMOL helped us to take a step forward in the theoretical, in the construction of our theory, And it is very important for social scientists to be able, through this platform, to access to the difficult use of generic computing and distributed computing tools. And of course, open questions remain, as always, because if we imagine other models with a different structure, how can we determine that they do better than ours? And shall we start with working with synthetic data or with observed data for simulation? And all this is summarized already in the two published books, marking the advance in this area thanks to OpenMOL platform. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Denise. Have we got questions for Denise?
I do, but I don't manage to open the little hand. Apologies.
That's okay, Elsa. That's no problem.
I was looking for the reactions, the applauses, everything. Anyway, hello. Thank you very much, Denise. For
nice to see you, Elsa.
Very nice to see you in this format. I was wondering whether you could tell us a bit more with respect to the data used for the validation of the models with respect to innovation.
In innovation, yes, I didn't say in the SimPop local model, we imagine a mechanism that make innovation endogenous to the system of cities and to the cities, and the hypothesis is that the more interactions you have among people, the more there is a probability for innovation. So this plays inside city. So innovation is likely to happen in cities of larger size or to be captured. It is the same process. And the more interactions you have with other cities, also improve the probability of the city to attract innovations. So you in this model, in this particular model, innovations are endogenously derived from the city size and the city proximity, connectivity with other cities. Whereas in the previous SimPop models, which were more complex, we have an input exogenously, historically, of innovation by creating, by simulating the creation of new wave of innovative activities. For instance, the first industrial revolution, the emergence of business services, the emergence of tourism activities, all over the centuries of the simulation. And of course, this could be tested with a more detailed information about a particular innovation if you get a good data set for that. But what we have done is not so much introducing them now in the complex model, but we have developed many statistical analyses on peculiar urban systems and type of innovations in order to check if our hypotheses were reasonable.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Denise. Thank you.
Any further questions for Denise?
If I may add, among researchers having worked on urban growth, there is a Brian Robson in UK. he made a very interesting study of urban development in England and Wales during the 19th century, and he connected this information with innovations directly with the statistical methods. He also tested for the first time the log normal distribution and the Gibbs process on urban development. And if you look at other work of the impact of innovation on urban systems, you have Alan Pred in the US, who made also a detailed historical studies at the in the 19th century mainly.
Thank you. Joost, you've got a question?
Yes, if I may ask one question, I maybe have already a bit of an answer, but I would like to have more precision also for the audience. I was wondering, how was the collaboration between computer scientists and geographer going during the project? And so, for example, to what extent the new methods developed were specific to some thematic question, and to what extent then these methods could be generalized to other issues?
Yes, you. I think you want me to tell about the spatial modeling, which is of course a concern for geographers, and we had in the team of PhD students in geography, people more specialized in what we call geomatics, and who were able to code themselves for sub parts of the software. And it was also important for developing visualization tool, especially maps and graphs, for displaying in a sensible way the results of the model. So, and the team have really worked hand in hand and each day on the same problems, and they try to find solutions, and they invented this, for instance, the multi-modeling method was invented by Clémentine Cotineau and Paul Chaperon, who is a computer scientist, Clémentine is a geographer, and they tried really to have each a total understanding of the model, both in what the code really was doing and which were the theoretical scientific ideas that the geographer wanted to apply. So I see this very important. I see it is crucial to really get advances in both sides.